So folks, welcome. It's the last session of TechEd. I'm sure most of us must be wrapping up, getting ready for the party, getting ready to leave and stuff like that. I hope TechEd has been good in terms of getting information about Microsoft technologies, and I hope that this last session will also be useful in terms of the kind of stuff that we have been doing. Right? So quick background in terms of the session, what we are going to be talking about and what we're going to be discussing in the next hour or so. This was an exercise that we did for a customer wherein they had a large network management application on Oracle, and they had did it as a project on Oracle, and they wanted to move it to SQL Server for financial as well as a scale-out kind of a benefits. And we'll look at the kind of benefits that they finally got as part of that kind of a stuff. Obviously, the customer was technology agnostic, and he had a doubt in terms of saying, you know, can SQL actually scale up to these kind of volumes? So the scenario was a network management kind of a solution wherein the data comes in 24/7. There is no let up in terms of the data. And on an average, they get something like 1 terabyte per day. And legally, they're required to keep at least a quarter's worth of data based on which they come back and do some rules and validations and logics like that. Right? So which essentially meant that 90 to 100 days, around 100 terabytes of data is what they had to come back and manage as part of that whole application. To quickly give you a perspective, this entire requirement in terms of managing 100 terabytes of data was 1/4 of their overall requirement. So it was a Malaysian telecom company, and for them, they wanted to implement this as part of one of their subsidiaries. And if they took the entire set of data across the entire telecom, that would be at least 4 times this size. Other telecom kind of operators in India, wherein the volume is much larger in China, etc., they would scale up to 10 times to 25 times this volume. Right? So that's the kind of volumes that we are talking about when we come back and look at gathering large amounts of data, on top of which we come back and do processing. Right? So I'll give you a quick perspective in terms of if there's a requirement like this, if there is a scenario like this, how do we come back and take a look at it, and what does SQL give us in terms of coming back and designing applications for these kind of volumes? My name is Praveen Shivatsa. I work as a director of a company called AstraSoft Consulting down in India. I also play the role of Microsoft Regional Director of Bangalore and an MVP. So I'll be walking you through the session. So, quick agenda. We will look through the case study. We will look through what we did. We look through the comparisons between Oracle and the SQL implementations and what are the kind of benefits we got. And we'll also look at key scaling points. Most of the things I talk about now, we'll come back and give you the high-level architecture, and nearly 80 to 90% of the work is something that you can do just by implementing this architecture. But there'll be a lot of fine-tuning that you will have to do as part of getting the final 10 to 15% of the performance, depending on the hardware, depending on the scenario, and depending on the structures that you are in. And that's also something that we'll quickly talk about as well. So, background, it's a network management application. It is used for mobile towers, Wi-Max networks, Wi-Fi networks, etc. ATM centers which have a mobile tower which sends out a log information. It collects all of this log information. There is a SLA agreement which says what is the level to which all of these towers will be up and operational. And all of that information is garnered from these logs. So all these various devices, all these various network points come back, capture all of this as part of their router data. And all of that is, there are small programs called agents which harvest all of this log information and come back and pump it out, right? So they use a UDP kind of a broadcast to come back and pump all the log information to the central tower. Logically, the telecom company is not very interested in this information at all, but legally, they have to keep on this information for a period of time. What the companies are very interested in is once they come back and collect all of this data, you need to analyze this data for security breaches, for rules, for other logical operations. You want to come back and see if an operation is happening from a single IP address continuously across multiple of your data points. You want to come back and see if people have logged on without logging off at multiple entry points. So you want to come back and they have a set of rules that they would like to run. They would like to analyze all of these rules for that data, and essentially they're looking at an alerts dashboard. So they want to have a dashboard which comes back and tells what are the amount of logs that are coming in. Is there traffic more in one part of the city as compared to the other? Is there some parts of the city which is down? Maybe there's a weather condition, maybe there's some other condition due to which some of the towers are down, right? Is that something that I can come back and quickly glean from this log data and come back and figure out that there is a problem in that area? So what they are interested in is to harvest all of this log information based on which they want to come back and have alerts and dashboards in terms of looking on top of all of this data. So they want to come back and do like a health monitoring across all of this various equipment. Now, key challenges in their existing NMS application, the structure was that the agents collect all of this data. The agents come back and put all of this into a log manager utility. So they collect all the data overnight, write them into CSV files. All the CSV files are shipped to a central storage or to a central location. And overnight, all of these files are looked through, imported, and then put into a database based on which all the reports, analysis, et cetera, are then harvested and run off. As part of the structure, their key requirement was the dashboard, which contained all the reports and stuff. So it was a system wherein you had 24/7 data coming in, but you also wanted a dashboard when you wanted some kind of a reporting of all the alerts and the information. From a data size kind of a perspective, roughly each record size was 0.5 KB per record. They were on an average getting 2,500 records per second per agent, and they had 10 agents, so which translated roughly around 25K records per second. So when you translate this down, it roughly comes to around 2 billion records per day, or 1 TB of data per day. And on top of this, they wanted to come back and do correlation and reporting across the last 100 days. So like I told you, they had to legally give out reports as part of their SLA, which said, this tower in this location has been operational and has not gone down for more than so much minutes in the last quarter, right? So that's the kind of data that they had, and that's the kind of reports that they were required to give out. The 100 days was a rotating window, so obviously, you know, after 100 days, you knock off one day and keep adding one day. So it was a continuous rotating window wherein we had to keep on to that kind of a data in terms of doing all the operations. As part of this, with Oracle, the current architecture that they had, they were collecting all of this data as part of the agents. Like I told you, they were storing all of this as part of CSV files. The agents collects all the data and writes it onto the CSV files. The CSV files would then come back and do a bulk load into Oracle. So all the data was shipped as part of FTP, compressed, zipped, etc., shipped onto the server, and there it was bulk loaded in. This process was extremely fast, in fact, faster than what SQL Server could do in terms of just collecting the data and bulk loading it in. But the pain that came about was the fact that after this, the data had to be indexed and analyzed. So once we loaded in all the data, 1 TB of data, we had to now come back and say, okay, in the last 24 hours, what all happened? Was there a lot of logins without logouts? Was there a lot of downtime? Were there some instances wherein the network tower came back and requested for a connection more than once continuously without having a disconnect kind of stuff? So they had to come back and analyze roughly around 100 rules across all the 1 TB of data continuously. And that process is something that ended up taking quite a long time. So the data was indexed, all the analysis was done, materialized views were created, post all that analysis, the dashboard was created. So if we came back and had a set of alerts that matched, came back and had a set of rules that matched on top of this data, all that was taken, sort of denormalized, put into a reporting set of tables, and that was what was used as part of the reporting dashboard. The raw data was stored for legal purposes, it was just kept around, but we would not be querying on the raw data on a regular basis. They would, however, want to drill down into the raw data. So at some point of time, if it came back and said you didn't meet a SLA agreement, they'd want to drill down into the log, take a dump of all of that, take a report of all of that. So we could not get rid of it, but it was hardly ever queried upon, right? So they still wanted it kept someplace. Now, as part of this, their current architecture, it was done as a project, which was done quite some time ago. So they had an app server. The app server was a Python-based application. They had two quad-core processors, 32 GB of RAM, 1 TB of hard disk, running Linux and a Python-based application. As part of the database server, they had 2 quad-core servers, 32 GB of RAM, and 1 TB of hard disk. Notice the little bit of a pain wherein they had a large amount of data space requirement on these servers because all of that was staging data. So all the CSV files which are being transported across were being sent into the Python server. The Python server would then come back and look at all of this and say, okay, I approve this, or I'll logically allocate, you know, some data across all of this in terms of what we can do, transfer it over to the DB server. And the DB server would then do a bulk load. So they had the entire thing happening as part of a staging, due to which they needed 1 terabyte on the app server and 1 terabyte on the DB server in terms of being able to do all the temporary operations. The entire data finally resided in an external storage, and it was a 200 terabyte external storage with 120 terabytes, which was usable. And the data was compressed, so it came down a little bit in terms of actually putting down the store. Now, key challenges that we had as part of the current architecture. The bulk data import, like I told you, was extremely fast. But after pulling in the data was not ready for consumption. It was not ready for analysis or reporting till all the indexes were built, till the materialized views were run, and till all the denormalization process of running through all the rules and checking them happened. And that would end up taking a long time. So there were periods of time wherein we actually came back and said, if you started getting data tonight and you started receiving all the data, end of day tomorrow night is when we would run the batch. Right? Till then, the data is just getting bulk loaded. End of day tomorrow night, we would create a new table for the next day. On the previous day's table, we would now come back, index everything. We would come back and create the materialized view. We would come back and run all the analysis in terms of the rules, and then come back and show the reports. The entire process of building the index, the materialized views, and running all the validations and logics itself could take anywhere from 4 up to 14 hours. Right? So we would have something like a 24 plus 4, 28 hours to 38 plus hours before I actually see the data in terms of appearing on my dashboard. And some of the alerts is something that they really could not wait that long for. Right? And it didn't make sense to them coming back and telling, 2 days ago you had a problem here. Right? It sort of, they already lost the context and it went off. So the dashboard didn't make much sense to them at all. Right? So with all of this data inserts going on, the index and analysis difference was slow. So like I told you, the lag from data collection to reporting was anywhere from 13 hours to 37 hours. Now, one of the things that we tried in Oracle is to come back and say, let's not do a CSV kind of a stuff, or let's not do a batched kind of an operation. Let us see if we can keep it online and come back and do stuff. Right? So we attempted coming back and importing all the data using CSV on an hourly kind of a basis, coming back and building all the indexes, coming back and running all the rules. And we realized that in an hour, we actually took more than an hour to finish that work. So what would happen was we would regularly run out of operations in terms of doing that stuff. And the problem was the inserts and the reads were happening on the same table at the same instance of time. So we would come back and create a table per day. And on the same table every hour, while we are importing the data, we would also be running all the indexes and the materialized views and stuff. Right? So given two large operations on the same table at the same point in time, the whole operation would slow down drastically. I'm sure there are alternatives in terms of how we can look at it, but one of the thought processes they had was some part of their stack, the reporting infrastructure, the dashboard infrastructure, was already on Microsoft technologies. So even though they were using Python for getting the data, they actually integrated reporting services into Python, and they used a Silverlight front end to actually come back and do all the dashboarding and stuff. So they came back and said, why don't we attempt to do all of this in SQL Server and see whether it'll stand up and see how it could work in this kind of infrastructure, right? So that's when we started taking a look at SQL Server to see if we can come back and do something similar on SQL Server. Two quick thought processes and notes there. If we had come back, taken exactly the same architecture and put it on SQL Server, we probably would have faced exactly the same set of problems, probably a bit more, right? In terms of the kind of issues that we face, wherein we try to do a CSV, we try to manage files, we try to import it, we try to index the data and stuff like that. But luckily and nicely, SQL Server gives us a whole set of new options in terms of how we can work with, right? And that's what we chose in terms of coming back and implementing something like this. So when we came back and looked at moving it onto a SQL Server kind of an architecture, the primary thought process was, how much of all of this work can we come back and parallelize, right? How much of all of this work can we come back and do without having a dependency on a same set of data or a single kind of a node, right? So we started off with taking all the data from the agents. We removed the entire process of using CSV files. We came back and said everything is only online. The agents sent the data using a UDP port. So rather than writing to files which were FTP'd, we opened up a port per agent and the agent wrote all the data into a UDP port directly. We accepted all of that as part of a WCF infrastructure. So we had a WCF service which had a bunch of ports open, which was collecting all of this data. And what it did was it came back and parallelized the entire operation and came back and wrote all of this into the database. As part of writing into the database, what we did was we used the concept of SQL Server Service Broker. So Service Broker is queues inside the database. It's the equivalent of MSMQ or MQ series. And these queues reside inside the database itself. So we came back and wrote all of this data onto the queues. And I'll show you a demo in terms of the performance difference and where the benefits occurred. And we took all of this data and parallelly wrote it into multiple queues inside the SQL Server endpoint itself. Once we wrote all of this data into SQL Server, into Service Broker, we had the choice of, on the background, processing all of this data from the queue. So we took all of this data from the queue, ran all our logics and performance kind of definitions behind this, reports, algorithms, rules, all of that is something that we ran behind this, and came back and stored the data into compressed tables. So we use SQL compression to come back and said, for all logging, auditing kind of a purpose, dump everything into a compressed table. But all the information that you need for reporting kind of a purpose, we came back and set it up in a parallel set of tables, which we came back and created them as partitioned tables, right? So we used a three-level structure. Step one, put everything into a service broker queue. From the service broker queue, come back and create all your reporting needs as part of a partition set of tables. And next, come back and dump all the audit or log information into a compressed set of tables for historical reporting, if so required, right? So that was the kind of flow through that we looked at in terms of implementing it on SQL Server. And the partition table is what fed into the reporting dashboard, and the compressed table was just kept there for historical kind of a purposes, for us to come back and look into the log structure. Now, as part of this, we tried out a few things. Step one, when we came back and removed the service broker, removed all the background processing, removed the asynchronous kind of a processing, and said, let WCF collect the data, let us just take this data, open a connection to the database, and come back and start writing it into it, right? And normal ADO.NET is what we do. ADO.NET, open connection, write into a database. As part of this operation, we came back and found that we could handle something like 33 records per second. Remember, it had a bunch of validations behind it, a bunch of logics behind it, and it could handle something like 33 records per second, which roughly translated to 2.85 million records per day, which was way lower than what we are attempting to do. Right? So if we come back and look at a structure which says SQL Server is there, I open a connection to it and just start writing into it, and I do all my business logic, either in .NET or in SQL stored procedures itself, it is something that using which we will not be able to achieve this kind of a scale. Right? So then we took it one step further and came back and said, let us now come back and start parallelizing all of this. Let's start come back and put all of this data into a service broker queue. And once we put it into a service broker queue, on the background, let's come back and start processing all of this information and coming back and putting it into the database. Right? The moment we did this and we started collecting all of these records in batches of hundreds, we found that we could do up to 25 batches per second per queue, which was 2,500 records per second per queue. So all we had to do was create a queue per agent. We had roughly around 10 agents, and we could come back and capture 25,000 records per second, which would come back, put all the data into an underlying database in terms of how it works, and take the whole thing forward. Right? So we had a base infrastructure for coming back and working with collecting a large amount of data as part of SQL Server using the service broker kind of an infrastructure. Second thing that we looked at doing was to come back and write all of this into parallelized correlation data. Right? So the moment we came back and partitioned the table, we realized that each partition is completely clear of the other partitions. So we could do things like collect all the data on one of the partition, run a set of queries and aggregations and rules. The other partitions is where you're doing all the insert. Once you're done, switch it over and do inserts into another partition. You come back and take the partition which is not being used and run all your correlations on that, right? So you have a nice way to come back and manage partitioning of your data as part of storing and working with all the logic. So it gives you an immediate infrastructure wherein your reads and writes are not happening to the same structure, are not happening on the same set of data at any given point of time, right? This itself is something that came back and helped us a lot in terms of cleaning up our reporting infrastructure to come back and make it clean from a performance kind of a standpoint. We took this, and like I told you, we also implemented compression for all the audit logs and stuff like that. And the compression is something that brought down the data storage quite a bit. But this is something that would have happened in any infrastructure. If you had used Oracle compression or you had used a CSV kind of a compression, you would have saved a similar kind of a data, right? The key benefit we got was in a regular infrastructure, if you have one common place where data is kept, the moment you compress the data, your queries on that slow down drastically. In this case, because we had stored all the data in log files in a compressed state, but we are actually querying from summarized data in partitions, the query and the data storage was not exactly the same. So we achieved the benefit of compression, but it did not take the hit of performance on querying on this data. Right? So that's how we sort of split the two out in terms of coming back and looking at it in terms of an overall infrastructure. The server configuration that we used using the SQL Server infrastructure, we had an app server, two quad core, very similar infrastructure, two quad core, 8 cores, 32 GB of RAM, 500 GB of hard disk, which itself was hardly ever used, Windows Server 2008 R2, WCF collector, and a Python app for reporting. So we did not change their infrastructure in terms of the existing application at all. So we let the entire Python application be as it is. It continued to use the reporting services embedded into Python. So the entire application dashboard continued to remain in Python without any drastic change at all. It's just that the agents, which was collecting the data, was shifted to WCF in terms of putting all the data. And on the DB server side, we had SQL Server 2008 R2, 64 GB of RAM, two quad core, 8 cores, 500 GB of hard disk, and a Windows server there. And we had a similar external storage, 200 TB of external storage on Windows storage server. Right? So infrastructure was similar, probably slightly lighter in terms of the hard disk utilization for temp storage, because we essentially did everything in memory as part of in-memory queues. Yes, we use the enterprise version of SQL Server. There's some features like partitioning and stuff which is supported only in the enterprise version, so we use the enterprise version of SQL Server. Right, so key benefits that we got in terms of moving to SQL Server was that the data transfer was continuous and it could be parallelized using more and more queues. So even though we had 10 agents and we came back and implemented 10 queues, we could potentially add another 10 queues and handle another terabyte of data in terms of coming in and putting it up. Right? I'm sure it does not scale linearly beyond that point. So I'm sure if I wanted one more terabyte of data instead of 10 queues, I probably would have to put 15 more queues. Right? And I'll tell you in terms of queue optimization, there are choices in terms of how I can distribute the data and take it further. Right? But it gave a nice scaling out option wherein we didn't exactly hit the top limits of what we could have possibly done. And it gave us a buffer wherein we could come back and actually push this a bit more in terms of scalability, in terms of how we are looking at it. Querying and analysis did not slow down the data. So whenever there were points of time wherein we were running reports, the dashboard was getting updated, we had to run queries, we had to get data from the log, et cetera, it did not slow down the insert process at all. So even from 10, 15, 20 rules, if we now came back and added another 40, 50 rules, it did not slow down the insert drastically. It gave a time shift, and I'll show that in a quick demo. So what you saw in 1 hour, you probably saw in 1.5 hours, right? But it did not slow down the entire insert process at all in terms of how you came back and ran all the logics for your analysis and stuff. This gave us the benefit that we could add on more complex analysis and reporting, and the lag time between collection and reporting from the time when the data came in to the time when I could actually see it on the dashboard came down to roughly around 1 hour, 12 minutes. Right? So it was anywhere from 1 hour to 1 hour, 15 minutes kind of a stuff with an average of around 1 hour, 12 minutes. And the primary benefit was because of the online architecture and not just taking the same architecture and putting it onto SQL Server kind of stuff. Right? So that was the primary difference in terms of the benefits that the customer got when they came back and took a look at a solution based on this kind of architecture. Some additional benefits that we got: historical data was compressed, reporting data was uncompressed but partitioned, so it gave us two different ways. One way of storing the data, one way of looking at the data. We had something called DB snapshots, which I'll quickly talk about, every hour, which gave a shorter window of analysis and reporting. So we could take a DB snapshot every hour. If we can tweak it a bit further, we could probably take DB snapshots every half an hour to come back and give a better reporting kind of a capability. Their logical requirement is they would want to come back and see the dashboard updated every 5 minutes. So I think we're still some distance away from that, right? But we have got it down from, you know, a day plus to an hour plus kind of a structure. We also have the option, which we used, of CLR procedures to come back and execute advanced rules. So a lot of rule sets, when we come back and execute, if it's dynamic, it kills our performance, right? So we had the option where we could come back and leverage something called CLR procedures to come back and look at advanced rules as well. Okay, so given this background, let me quickly switch over and get into the demo part of it. So this is a simulated demo. In an NMS kind of application, everything happens in the background. Okay, you just get the data from somewhere, it goes somewhere, all you see is a dashboard. So what I've done is I've created a simulator where I can simulate the kind of data that we want, and we can come back and take a look at it in terms of how it would come back and execute. So I'll walk you through the code, and I'll put up the code sample as well if you want to come back and play around with it. Okay. So two parts to this. One, I've got a simulator wherein I come back and simulate the data, and I'll walk through in terms of the kind of data I'm simulating. Second part is the graph, which comes back and tells me number of records. Remember, in a real scenario, they're not interested in number of records. They're interested in number of records which didn't match rules. That's the only set of data that they're looking at, right? But in our case, we'll come back and take a look at both parts of them. We'll just come back and take a look at how many records are there and what is the kind of output that will happen when we come back and look at a added on rules kind of stuff. So step one, let me start this whole stuff. Oops, I already have some data. Clear existing data. Okay. So when we come back and start writing to DB directly, this is the step I told you. All we are doing here, getting data, opening a ADO.NET connection, insert into the table in a loop, continuous loop, and getting out, right? So we come back and support 200 odd transactions per second. There is slight variations in between because of number of connections, open connections and stuff. And with a laptop, it varies a bit more. But on an average, we can come back and support somewhere around 200 odd transactions per second in terms of doing all of these operations. Tapers off. Now, when I come back and start logging using a queue, it comes back and starts giving me 2,800 to 3,000 transactions per second in terms of the kind of volume that it accepts, in terms of inserting into the table. So this is not just, so all the dashboard is doing is it's querying number of records from the table, right? So it's not records that I'm inserting into the queue, but it's the records inserted into the queue which are being picked up, which are being processed and finally being put into the table, right? So that is something that we can average out around 2,400 to 3,000 transactions per second. So the difference is over 10 times in terms of what you can see, right? Now, I'll show you the interesting part. Let me clear off this data again. It comes back. Now, let me go to SQL Server. So this is my procedure for inserting the data, and this is my procedure for processing the queue. Now, what I'll do is I'll come back and add a delay. Turn this. Now, logically, we would have a business component here which comes back and does some work. Right? That is the one which takes every record, runs a whole bunch of processes, runs rules, runs checks. Unfortunately, the way they had designed it, some of these rules were dynamic. So if the requirement was there, like recently they came up and said, if device is BlackBerry, run these additional set of rules. Right? So if you want to come back and add on rule sets like this, you wanted some of those rules dynamic as well. So each query, in terms of validating all the rules, et cetera, could end up taking some time. So let's begin by just adding a 0.5 second kind of an alteration. And the moment we do this, and we come back to our dashboard,
data, reset, start writing to the database, we see we come down to like 2 records per second, 3 records per second, right? So we are adding a delay there in terms of doing all of this stuff, and that brings it down drastically. Now, let's go back and add a similar kind of a delay to our queue, because obviously we would be doing a similar kind of a process there as well. So I'll come back and add a similar wait for delay there. Simulate login to the queue. Right? So you see, even with a delay, it still continues to process a similar set of data. Right? It continues to come back and work with, you know, similar kind of a delay. Just to show you in terms of how it works, if you notice there is a small stagger there, right? It's something which wasn't there before. If you notice, there's a small stagger. So I'll just increase the delay further, just for the queue part, and now come back and say, you know what, let's add much more complex rules. Instead of 0.5 second, let's give it 2 seconds per query. Right? Now I come back and do this. Okay. Now notice how it works. It takes the delay, but if you notice, it now processes 4,700 records per second. Right? So because I've just done on the last second kind of a stuff. If you average it out, you will still get around 2,500 to 3,000 records per second. Right? So nicely what is happening is, if you come back and add a delay, if you come back and add a lot of processing, if you come back and add a lot of rules and logics behind it, all of that is happening behind the scenes, and it is not something that's slowing down your inserts. Your inserts are going into the queue as it is. The processing behind the queue does take time, but it's happening in a parallelized fashion. And that is what comes back and gives you the benefit that you can come back and scale out quite a bit as part of all of these operations. So what are the key steps of this? What are the key markers in terms of how we come back and set up this kind of infrastructure? Just to run you through a background, we set up the database, we set up the tables, we set up the queue, right? A queue, if you are not aware, it was introduced in SQL 2005. It's been enhanced quite a bit now. So a queue is an infrastructure inside the database. You don't have to change code. You don't have to change .NET code. You don't have to change any other code. In fact, if you're talking from PHP to SQL Server, from Python to SQL Server, you can just continue using the same infrastructure, right? No drastic change. You set up a queue, like you say, create table, et cetera. You come back and create a message type, create a contract, create a queue. Once you create a queue, wherever you are inserting into the database, all you now do is you just come back and say, I will create a conversation and send on conversation. So the T-SQL syntax to actually insert into table will now change to come back and say, send on conversation, right? And it makes the process asynchronous. Every time you do a send on conversation, it puts the data into a queue. On the other side of the queue, you now come back and pick up and process the queue. So you now have a process queue which comes back and says, receive from queue. So it can receive records multiple at a time. It receives from the queue and does the operation in terms of what you were doing. So that is the one that comes back and does the insert into the table. Right? And the way you tie in the two infrastructures together is you now come back and as part of your service, as part of your queue, you say with activation, what is the procedure name, maximum parallel readers, and what is the execution? So look at the structure that you put. It's like a trigger on the queue. You've created a queue. You've come back and said, I push into the queue. Inherently, by definition, a queue is a first in, first out. So there's no collision between writers and readers. So it comes back and just keeps accepting ins from one side, and it processes the other end of the queue. On the other end of the queue, using this syntax, we have tied it into an activation stored procedure. So every time a message comes in, automatically that activation stored procedure is triggered. But the difference is we have the ability to come back and do a max queue readers. And this supports up to 16,000 queue readers. So I can come back and trigger off 16,000 parallel executions of stored procedures behind the scenes. The queues are smart in the sense that it comes back and gives you a guaranteed one-time only delivery, which means if a record has been picked up by one of these stored procedures instances, it gives you a guarantee that the other one will not pick it up. Okay? So that's something that it internally does, which is why whenever we come back and work with queues, we also declare a transaction. So we come back and say, begin transaction, commit. And we come back and say, whenever we are reading stuff, begin transaction, commit. These transactions are not the equivalent of table transactions that we're working with. This is a transaction which just ensures that operations with the queue are consistent. I either read a message or I put it back into the queue. Right? Queues are persisted as part of the database. So at some point of time, you know, system hangs, I reboot the system, all the data in the queue is as it is. Whenever it comes back, it just continues processing. Right? Gives me the ability to come back and not lose information. If I put everything into a MSM queue, if I put everything into a MQ series, if I put everything into my own application queue in .NET or in Python, that application had crashed, I would have lost all the messages in the queue. There's no backup strategy for that. There's no recovery for that. That would have been out of sync with my database and so on and so on. Right? Having all of these queues inside my database itself gave me the advantage that it's part of my backup strategy. It's part of my same admin strategy. There's nothing more that I had to do as part of that infrastructure. Right? So you saw the advantage that I could now introduce a delay here. I could now introduce a wait for kind of a process here. I could now come back and say, you know what, I actually will wait much longer here. 2 seconds to say 5 seconds, right? And it'll come back and continue the kind of operations that it was doing with a slightly longer delay. Bumps it up. Right? So you saw a delay, it'll wait for 5 seconds, and then you'll suddenly see 10,000 records. Right? Just clear and show. Right. So now we have added on a delay of 5 seconds. So it comes back and processes all of that nodes. Right? So it gives you a nice infrastructure wherein you can come back and scale out in a parallelized kind of a mode. Like I told you, if you are handling 2,500 transactions, 25,000 transactions in 10 queues, I want to handle another 25,000 transactions, I just add 10 more queues. They're all running in a parallel mode. Most of the inserts, because it's all inserts, they don't collide with each other into the underlying table. And I'll come to that in a second in terms of having a table partition, wherein you can partition for each of the agents independently, wherein there's no collision at all, and you can come back and put this entire infrastructure to scale out horizontally quite a bit in terms of the kind of things that you can come back and do with it. Just clear this. Okay. So at a high level, that was a quick walkthrough in terms of how we had structured the application. So primarily, the application came back and said, collect data. It's a 24/7 kind of a collection. This infrastructure would be useful if you're collecting data from devices. Whenever humans are there in terms of inputting the data, our concurrent users is quite less. Right? We do a few hundred transactions per day. I don't think we can actually enter more than that. But if you're collecting data like, pings from a cell phone, you're collecting data like, statistics from a game, you're collecting data like statistics from an airport or medical device statistics, which is tied onto your wrist and it has a regular statistics which you keep pumping in from multiple different people kind of a stuff. So any time wherein you have devices which come back and keep pumping information, you start hitting these scenarios wherein the kind of transaction logs that you get, the kind of transaction inputs that you get start growing dramatically. Right? And in those kind of infrastructure, if you want to come back and scale it out, you can resort to this kind of a structure wherein there is no change to the application. All the change is from the database onwards. So at a high level, you probably would have already had a stored procedure which inserts the data. You just override that and say, instead of inserting data into a table with a whole bunch of validations, I'll put it into a queue. On the other side of the queue, I'll take the same stored procedure and activate it, right? And that does all the stuff in the background. And even if there is a delay, it just delays the stuff, but it can handle large amount of parallel operations in terms of being able to come back and run it in parallel, right? There are some fine tunings that we need to do. So while the high level infrastructure is good, there are some things that we need to keep in mind. Service broker, it gives us the advantage that it's a queued operation like MSMQ or MQCDs, but it's also a different way of working. It's an asynchronous way of working, right? In a synchronous way of working, the moment I put the data, it is guaranteed that it's already inside the system, even though there's a delay for me, right? But in asynchronous kind of a manner, I put it into a queue, and I hope that it will get processed. There will be instances wherein the data is not in your table, it has come from the device, and it's sort of nowhere. If you actually go back and take a look at it, it'll be hanging around in the queues, right? Something would have happened, something would have broken as part of the queue infrastructure, you know, queue log out of space kind of a stuff. And based on that, you will see that you just have a whole bunch of records getting queued up as part of the queue, right? You need to come back, tweak it, clean it up, and then it'll come back and start processing all of that, right? So you have to be careful that administratively or from a way of working, it's slightly different, right? But in terms of changes to code, changes to the structure, not too much at all. You can create multiple parallel queues. So you can come back and have one too many queues. You can also come back and route queues. Queues are pretty interesting and nice. You can come back and route queues from one server to another server as well. So instead of having a queue which has the insert and the receive, the send and the receive on the same machine, you can come back and have the insert on one machine, but the receive on a different machine. So you can configure a queue to have an insert endpoint on my machine, but a receive endpoint on a different machine, right? So look at the structure like this. You could actually have multiple SQL expresses, and you're inserting into all of them. And all of them have the insert queue endpoint. All of their receive queue endpoint is on SQL Server Enterprise Edition. So you just insert into the local express editions, and each of them will in turn connect and pump it into SQL Server, right? The slight difference there you would get is the transport protocol from service broker to service broker is a compressed binary kind of a format, right? So instead of you sending it over the wire using ADO.NET, it sends it in a compressed binary kind of a format, and both the endpoints are secured. So it is a secure transmission across SQL Server service broker from one endpoint to another, right? So that's another way of coming back and having a central enterprise edition with multiple spokes into which you write, which further come back and deliver to the enterprise edition. The other advantage that you get with that is number of connections reduces, so not everyone is connecting to the enterprise edition, right? So open connection, you know, ADO.NET connections, et cetera, reduces. All of them are working with their local SQL Express kind of a database, using which they come back and pump it into the enterprise edition. You have the addition, you have the benefit of the activation stored procedure. Like I told you, as part of the activation stored procedure, you can come back and activate, you know, 16,000 stored procedures, but you have to remember that it does not help you beyond a certain point of time. The activation stored procedure, the number of parallel activations, should be in sync with the number of cores that you have. The moment it goes beyond the number of cores that you have, you'll have a contentions in terms of CPU utilization time, beyond which all of them will keep waiting anyways, right? So given the fact that they run in parallel, if you have a four-core system, we typically come back and say you can have up to 16 parallel operations. You have a two-core system, in a demo you can push it up to 20, but regularly have something like, you know, 4 to 8 kind of a parallel processing, right? But you have the benefit of coming back and doing multiple parallel operations just if you have more CPU nodes, more computing nodes. And that part is something that uses a large number of computing nodes and not too much of memory. Good and bad side to queues. Queues store all the data in a persisted manner. It happens in an asynchronous manner, but it stores the data in a persisted manner. So the good part about queues is, like I told you, it's part of your backup, it's part of your recovery, and it's part of that whole infrastructure. The bad part is because it writes into the log and writes into the disk at some point of time, it is one notch slower than writing it in MSMQ or a memory queue, right? So that's a slight trade-off. But typically, we have seen it's a more than acceptable trade-off, given the kind of benefits that you get with it. It gives you a guaranteed one-time-only delivery. So when you come back and put it into a queue, you will not, even if you have 16,000 stored procedures being triggered at a point in time, you will not have more than one procedure
pick up the same record at any given point of time. So that's a guarantee that the queue infrastructure itself comes back and gives it to you, right? And like I told you, you can also come back and scale it by transmitting data across databases, right? So you can sort of distribute the whole application in terms of the way they work. Few other things to note, and I'll quickly show this again as a demo. You can configure multiple packets per conversation. You can bulk load multiple records. You can transform and bulk insert XML into that. And you can do further optimizations. There are a few white papers in terms of how to tweak the service broker queue. There are options to tweak the service broker queue from 2,000 transactions per second all the way up to 10 to 25,000 transactions per second for a single queue, right? So that's the kind of performance that you can push a single queue to in terms of coming back and working with it, right? So that's the kind of advantage that you get when you're working with the service broker infrastructure. So let's quickly switch back. So in this, what I'm doing is I'm taking the same queue, just the queue infrastructure, and I'm configuring three different parameters, right? I'm configuring the number of records, so I want to limit it. I just don't want to keep pumping it infinitely. So we have a hold over what we are doing. I'm configuring something that we call the batch size, and I'm configuring something that I call the conversation size. Now, before I begin, let me actually just reduce all of these. So this essentially will put only 10 records for me, and that's all it'll ever do. Let me go in the background and alter the queue with activation status off. So what I'm doing is I'm essentially capturing 10 records into the queue and just stopping there. And beyond that, I'll manually show you how it works and how it gets triggered and stuff. So I remove the activation. If I come back and take a look at it, I should not have anything in the queue right now. Right, so zero records in the queue right now. There's nothing in the queue right now. I will come back. This is not very used. Conversation one, put it in, it stops. So what this essentially did was it came back, put 10 records into my queue, right? I can do all my operations like select from a queue, etc. A select is the equivalent of a peek. So I'm looking at it, but not processing it. But the moment I come back and say receive, that one conversation goes away. Now, I have all of this data into my queue. Take a look at what happens. Okay, take a look at the data first. All the data that it puts into a queue is XML based. So it's like a packet, it has a message data. I can choose to either put data as XML or binary. Binary is slightly more compressed and slightly more faster, but interpreting that is additional pain, right? For ease of demo, et cetera, we prefer to come back and do a XML kind of a stuff. Now, inside the XML, I don't need to send one record at a time. So I can batch it up depending on the packet size. So I can optimize it for my network packet as well as memory packet. So depending on how much of all of this data will be in memory till it gets put into the queue, right? So I can come back and based on that, I can optimize the batch size. So instead of a batch size of 10, I can take it up to, you know, 80, 100. On a 64-bit system with better RAM, I can actually go all the way up to 800, 1,000. But you should play around with it. Beyond a certain point, you will start seeing that it decreases in performance because the amount of data that you're transferring over the network itself becomes so huge that your performance starts degrading. So all of these have optimal values, right? Depending on a certain scenario, depending on a certain machine infrastructure that you've got. Now, given that I have all of these packets, let me come back and manually process this, right? When I process this, as part of my process queue, I have put a debug statement, select. So it essentially comes back and tells whatever I'm inserting it in, I will just select and show it to you. So we get a debug output in terms of what is happening behind the scenes. So come back. Oops, sorry here. So I come back and say I have got 10 of these. Let me execute this. Okay. Now if you notice, it came back and processed only one record. And if I come back and take a look at it from account, from the table,
from the queue, it has 9 still, right? So what happened was, even though I came back and said, process that entire queue, and if you take a look at it, I have received top 1,000, right? Which means received 1,000 at a given point in time. It still came back and processed only one of these records at a time, right? And the reason for that is something that we call as conversations as part of queues. So in queues, what happens is, if you take a look at the kind of outputs that we have got here, we see a conversation ID, conversation group ID, and a conversation handle. And if you notice, each of the conversation handles are different. 8611, 8A11, 8E11, 9211, so on and so forth, right? Now, whenever we come back and say receive gets or pulls out all the messages for one conversation at a time, right? Which means if I come back and have one conversation ID per record that I put in, it'll actually only process one at a time, right? And it's something that is still not very optimal for me. So let me just go ahead and clean up this queue. Right, so I would have to do, I have a 5-second delay. Just remove that 5-second delay as well. Much easier. So execute. It should be done, right? So it came back and only gave me one record at a time. Now, if I come back here and I say conversation size 10, for example, and I insert it into it, and I stop. I take a count. It tells 10 records. I take a look at this. I have similar 10 records. Each one of them internally has, 10 records each. That's roughly around 100 records. But if you notice, all of them have exactly the same conversation ID, right? So they have the same conversation handle. Now, in this case, when I come back and say execute this, let's also count how many records are there in the table. 100 right now. So I come back and process this. It processes all 10 at one shot, right? So not only 10, it can process up to 1,000 messages. You can actually push it beyond 1,000 as well, depending on how much of RAM you've got, how much of processing power you've got on the server. You can process all of them as a batch, but remember that it will only process one conversation at a time. So the decision that we have to take is how many messages do we put as part of one single conversation, right? From a queue perspective, think of a conversation as a logical batch of operations. So if I come back and say, in one conversation, I want to put 1,000 records in, it will treat that entire conversation batch as one set of records, and you'll say, this conversation is done, closed, done, throw it away, right? So there are a few white papers in terms of how I can come back and optimize my whole conversation handling, etc., to come back and give me a much better performance, right? So we need to come back and take a look at how we are generating conversation IDs for us to come back and push it up to do bulk operations internally. Without that, we will still be doing one record at a time, and the performance will considerably slow down. And even though it's happening in parallel, you will see that from 200 transactions per second that we do, it probably comes up to around 600 to 800, but it still sort of stops there if you don't come back and optimize the conversation ID that you come back and generate as part of all of these transactions. So now it would have come back and put all of this at one shot, right? 200 records. Go back, add on activation part back. Small change back to demo one. Just sort of let it run. Right. Okay, so you saw that Service Broker does give us a queuing kind of a benefits, right? It does give us enormous scalability. You can come back and actually handle like 10,000 records per second, even with validations, with code logic behind the scenes. One of the benefits that we got in terms of moving to this architecture was initially where we lived with just three or four rules, wherein we had three or four rules and it took us, you know, a bunch of time to come back and execute that. We saw that now we can add on, you know, another 20 rules and it would just delay the initial process, but it would still handle the same number of records per second because it just came back and parallelized the entire process, right? So it gave us a very scale out kind of a model in terms of putting back all of this and taking it forward as part of doing all of this operation. Now, the next step was, even though we came back and did all of this as part of the service broker, we came back and collected the data parallelly, we came back and did all the analysis, et cetera, we had to still, at some point of time, come back and persist it in. And we had to still do the dashboarding part, wherein the dashboard was coming back and picking information continuously. Right? So there was still one section, which was the summarized data part, wherein a write and a read had to happen in parallel across both of them. Right? So in such cases, one of the things that we did was we started using the concept of partitions. Partitions was again introduced in SQL 2005. In SQL 2005, you could just do the partitions, but it would not parallelize a lot of your operations. Right? So in SQL 2008, we have taken that to the next step, wherein you can now come back and do a lot of operations parallelly as part of a table partition infrastructure. So for example, now your table locks automatically get escalated up to a partition level instead of to a table level. So if I'm doing heavy operations on one of the partitions, only that escalation happens only to that lock level, only to that partition level. Right? It's actually a hint. We have to come back and say create table with, you know, locking equal to either a default or a table or a, you know, partition kind of a definition. So you have the choice of coming back and saying, I will create multiple partitions, and as part of each partition, I'll work independently. It allows fast archiving with the switch partition kind of an operation. It allows a partition level management rather than a table level management. Now, what we did as part of the design of the solution was to come back and say, instead of coming back and doing a partition based on time-based, which is how we would logically do it, if I have a partition based on time, and I say R1 goes into one partition, or day one goes into one partition, all my agents are writing into the same partition at the same time. And I'm reading the same partition for all my summarized kind of a data, right? So it's something that wherein I would have a contention for my inserts and my reads. So what we did was, we did a two-step process. We created a calculated column wherein we wrote our own logic of how to generate a partition ID, and we came back and now partitioned based on this ID. And what is the logic we used? We came back and said, for every agent, we'll create two partitions, right? It was a binary, 0 or 1. And every R, we would switch it out, right? So we'd come back and say, if the R is divisible by 2, it goes into one partition. If it's not divisible by 2, it goes into another partition. 10 agents, 20 partitions. Now, look at the structure. In 1 hour, 9 to 10 in the morning, all 10 would be writing into one set of them. Post 10 o'clock, all of them are writing into the second set. And the first set is completely read-only. Nobody's looking at it. It's completely sitting idle. We can do all our reporting on that. We can do all our number crunching on that. And it's pretty nice in terms of coming back and looking at it. Right? The next R, automatically it would switch back and insert data into the first partition. The second partition is now free for us in terms of coming back and reading on it. Right? We could probably have further narrowed it down, you know, 15 minutes, 20 minutes kind of a stuff. But doing that kind of a switch is painful. Having calculated columns is painful. So we just came back and chose to do it on an hourly kind of a basis. Right? So there's one more limitation, which going forward sort of goes away. We also had the limitation that we can at max create 1,000 partitions. So initially we had the idea of coming back and saying, let's create a partition by day, or let's create a partition per hour, or let's create a partition, you know, every 10 minutes or 15 minutes kind of a stuff across all the agents. Right? Now beyond a certain point of time, we had only 1,000 partitions that we could play around with. So we had to do some kind of a switching kind of logic. Quick information there, SQL 2008 Service Pack and SQL 2008 R2 Service Pack 1, they have come back and they're updating the limit to 15,000 partitions. Right? So you go from 1,000 partitions to 15,000 partitions. So the kind of things that you can play around with in terms of having partitions suddenly becomes so much more. Right? You literally can have something like a partition per hour across the whole year kind of a stuff. Right? So that's the kind of number of partitions that you get in terms of scaling out. The nice part of the partition is, every time you're working with one part of the partition, all the rest of the data in the same table is untouched by you. And given the fact that all your lock escalations and resource allocations happens on a per partition kind of a basis now, it makes the process so much more cleaner and simpler. Second benefit we got was compression has been taken to the partition level now, right? So you have a choice of saying partition one compression in a different, sorry, compress one partition in a different way, compress a different partition in a different way. So you can have different logics of compression for different parts of your partition, right? So the partition in which we were archiving the data, we had a high level of compression. The partition in which we were storing all the summarized data for us to come back and do reporting, we didn't have compression at all, right? So this is the kind of configuration that you can come back and pull off as part of table partitioning and compression planning on a table infrastructure. Key definition in terms of how we came back and used it, create a logical partition to switch and to parallelize inserts. So if we came back and said, you know, per agent create a partition, we could have created a partition per agent, but then we would not have been able to do reads. If we had come back and said, do a partition per R, then in the same R, everyone is writing into the same data, right? So either ways, we would have ended up with some kind of a collision between writes and reads. So what we did was we used a combination of time as well as logical operations, right? And we created our own functional calculated column based on which we came back and implemented all the partitioning. The nice part about the logical way of partitioning, our own computed column of partitioning, is you can quickly write your function to generate this computed column. And tomorrow, if you want to change your partitioning logic, you know, just go back and redo that function. So if you have 10 partitions, all you need is a 1 to 10 number. How you generate that 1 to 10 number, you decide based on a function rather than based on a data. So that gives you the flexibility that if you want to change that logic over a period of time, just update your function and you're sort of done, which generates that whole computed column. One of the additional things that you can do is you can also align all your indexes per table partitions, right? This is something that we have debated internally. If I align my indexes along with my table partitions, is it necessarily good or bad? It gives me the benefit that I go to one place or one disk for both my data and my indexes. But it gives me the disadvantage that the same drive is reading both parts of the data, right? If I actually had indexes separately and my data separately, it would have read my indexes, and as I got my index pointers, I could have parallelly read my data, right? But by putting both of them onto the same disk, I'm sequencing that whole operation, right? So ideal setup is one partition per, you know, table structure that we want, and a parallel separate logic for all my indexes, which means I would love to actually have, if I'm doing 20 partitions, 20 DAT files, one for each of my partitions, and 20 index files for each of these partitions, right? But that's something that we need to plan out. But ideally, your indexes and your data must be aligned. They should use the same partition function. They should use a similar kind of a concept across both of them. You can, as part of compressions, you can enable compression at a row or a page level. When you do at a page level, it takes the entire 8K and compresses it down, gives you larger advantage. Typically, the benefit is a slower performance when querying. Right? But that is something that you should come back and look at it from an archive kind of a perspective. Right? And you can plan the table row size in alignment with the page size. So that's something that we need to do as part of design anyways. Right? So quickly switching back. So in our case, what we have done is we have our table, and as part of the table, we have multiple partitions that we set up. We create a logic, and we come back and say, this is the partitioning range. So left of 5, put it into one of the partitions, right of 5, put it into another partition. In a physical environment, what we did was we essentially came back and, like I told you, said 10 agents, 20 partitions. So we created, you know, a 1 to 20 kind of an ID and came back and said, put them into 20 different partitions. We created a partition schema which told us which of these values goes into what part of the data, right? And then we came back and created this whole table. So what we did was we had an ID, which was the transaction ID which we were using, but we created a calculated column DID, right? Which is a device plus an identifier ID, right? And we came back and said, this is a computed column. Like I told you, every R we will switch it. So if it's divisible by 2, then I'll come back and put it as 0. If it's not divisible by 2, I'll come back and put it 1, right? And I will add that on a per device ID. So we generated our own logic of the DID. And all the partitioning is something that we came back and did on the DID basis, right? We created the index clusters on that, all the rest of the structures on that. Now, notice that by adding partitions, the rest of the application infrastructure does not know about it at all. So it's a pure admin-related work. It is something that you can do behind the scenes, does not require any code change at all, right? So you come back and just plan for it. The developer need not even be aware of that whole partitioning infrastructure. From a performance point, he should be, right? But from a code and just, you know, executing the code kind of a perspective, it's something that he need not even be aware of. If you come back and take a look at the table, we now have an option to manage partition. So you have the option of coming back and saying, I want to manage partition in a sliding window scenario. So obviously you can do this through scripts and code, but you have the option of coming back and saying, at a point in time, I want to switch in a partition, I want to switch out a partition, right? So at any point of time, you can come back and say, take this partition for device ID, you know, 10 with a flag of 1, switch it out into another table. This is one of the ways that we can come back and do archiving or moving it into a historical kind of a table. Now look at this structure. I come back, put all the data, I do all my reporting logic, I figure out everything. At a point in time, I have to move the data to an archive table because it's no longer in my live table. Right? Typical process of moving something to the archive table is select star from here, insert into that, delete, which is a very heavy operation, even if nobody else is looking at it. If you come back and do a partition switch, you're coming back and changing a pointer. Right? You're coming back and saying, this data which was there in this dat file continues to remain there. But instead of table A having a pointer to this data, I will now have table B having a pointer to this data. And because it's a pointer switch, it happens in a short period of time. It's like attaching or detaching a database, right? A similar kind of an operation. There is no data movement, right? So whether you do a switch with, you know, 100 GB of data, you do a switch with 10 GB of data, you do a switch with any size of data, the time taken is very similar. It's a pointer change. That's all it is, right? So if you plan well, you can come back and do something like this quickly to come back and archive all of this data. And it's something that you just have to do as a pointer switch and not as a movement of data. Second thing is part of the same structure. You have the ability to manage compressions. And like I told you, you have the choice of just using the same compression for all the partitions, or you can come back and say, you know what, I've got these different partitions. Right now I've got two partitions. For one of them, I want a row compression. For one of them, I want a page compression, right? So like I told you, historical data, the one that we want to archive, put a page compression, archive it, right? The one that I want to keep it for my reporting, come back and put a row compression, or preferably don't put any compression at all. Just store it raw so that we can come back and do all our query, right? So you have choices in terms of how to optimize the storage between saving space versus performance for all your reporting. Right? And you can choose an in-between mix of both of them in terms of coming back and pulling this off. Okay. Last few things that I wanted to quickly share with you as part of the application infrastructure. Like I told you, at a high level, this design, like I showed you, even on a laptop, it can pull off around 2,000 to 3,000 transactions per second per queue. Just by putting 10 queues, you can hit like 25,000 to 30,000 transactions per second, which roughly translates out to a billion plus records per second, right? And that's the kind of infrastructure that you can get on a, you know, simplistic kind of an hardware. But there are some fine-level tunings that you can additionally come back and do when you're using it in an enterprise scenario, right? So if you're using it with validations, a whole lot of other logics, et cetera, there are additional tunings that you can do. Step one, we have got something called database snapshots. So database snapshots are read-only copy. They come back and take a snapshot of your database. The pain that we have got in our 24/7 system is if I come back and say I want a report at 9 o'clock, at 9 o'clock, I'm getting 25,000 transactions, right, in that 1 second. I'm not sure how much of that is included in this, how much of that is not included in this, how much of that is getting double reported as part of 9 o'clock report and 10 o'clock report, right? So I'm truly not sure of what is happening behind the scenes in terms of an exact count. So one of the things that we noticed is if we make it online and do reporting and we add up the reports and take a summarized data, they would not match, right? And they would continuously keep going off track. One of the things that we can do as part of that is to come back and use database snapshots. When you take a database snapshot, it comes back and takes a read-only copy of the entire database at a given instance of time. Again, it's like a pointer, whether you've got 10 GB, 100 GB, 1 terabyte. Your taking of a snapshot is just instantaneous, right? It hardly takes any time at all. What it does is it creates a structure which is blank, and it adds pointers back to the underlying DAT files of the original source. So if you come back and take a database snapshot, it creates its own database. You take a look at those DAT file properties, it'll come back and say, you know, 250 GB is the file space. But if you say space on disk, it says 258 KB, right? Because essentially it comes back and says, I could grow to this, but all I have is pointers back to the original space. And because it's coming back and creating pointers, a snapshot happens at an instance in time. So I can take a snapshot at 9 o'clock. I know all queries against the snapshot gives me data as of 9 o'clock, and that's it. I will not have any difference in terms of counts, aggregations, etc. Right? So it gives me a very nice way to come back and put checkpoints based on which I can come back and harvest all my information. Good for exporting, good for, you know, taking a backup, temp kind of a backup, good for reporting, good for validations, etc. Second thing is a whole bunch of XML operations. Not very recommended, but given the fact that you're getting data from devices, etc., it makes it more readable. Right? Binary is obviously preferred. We have seen that whenever we move data from XML to binary, we get an additional 3 to 5% benefit in terms of performance. Right? But XML is something that Service Broker internally uses a lot. In fact, Service Broker technology itself is something Microsoft uses a lot. Right? Behind the scenes for replication, behind the scenes for notification, any asynchronous kind of an operation, internally SQL Server has started using this infrastructure. Right? So in that sense, it's getting decently robust. XML operations is something that you can do quite well. In fact, if I quickly switch back here. You will notice that when we come back and do a read, we do a read from XML, right? So we take multiple records of XML, each having multiple records. So it's like 100 XML, 100 records per XML, and 100 XMLs at a time. That's 10,000 records, right? This one insert statement actually processes all the 10,000 records at one shot, right? So it's quite nice in terms of it coming back and working with this stuff. An alternative to using XML would be to use the table variable that we've introduced. You can now pass a table as a parameter, right? And that gives you the benefit that you can pass bulk data into a procedure. That's something that you should come back and look at leveraging. And the other last thing that we used was what we called as CLR stored procedures. So when we come back and write stored procedures in SQL Server, no, it creates a query plan, it creates an optimization plan, it's better than ad hoc query, etc. But if I write a procedure which says, you know, count from 1 to 1,000,000, what's the query plan for it? There is no query plan, because the query plan is what is the best way to access data, and is not accessing data at all, right? So what happens in this case is it executes the entire thing like a script, right? And the performance would be as bad as a JavaScript or a VB script. It's not in a compiled kind of a code, right? So whenever you want to write cursors, whenever you want to write algorithms, whenever you want to write logical operations, it is not optimal to do that in T-SQL. T-SQL is optimal and excellent and best for data access. But for everything else, it's not necessarily optimal. That is where you have the logic of CLR stored procedures. So in our case, validations, rules, checks, you know, checking for a certain pattern, etc., are much better done as CLR stored procedure. And we saw anywhere from a 200% improvement in performance of those business rule implementations. Right? So even internally, Microsoft, whether it uses spatial data type, hierarchy data type, etc., they're all implemented as CLR data types itself. Right? And that's where you get the performance benefit of computing as against data access. Right? So if you put all of these together, I think the primary difference is when we take a look at SQL Server, we come back and put tables, put a few indexes, and we hope that it really scales. Right? Unfortunately, that is not valid for all scenarios. SQL Server does give multiple different options. It gives you the options of Service Broker, gives you the options of table partitions, gives you the options of compression, gives you the option of XML or bulk data operations like table data sets, gives you the option of database snapshots to come back and put a read-only check at a point in time, gives you the options of CLR stored procedures to come back and do computing in a much faster fashion, right? From an architecture perspective, we need to look at all of these and fit them in into our scenarios. And that's when we can literally push SQL Server to what I tend to call as infinite scalability, because it's paralyzed, right? You just throw more hardware at it, throw more queues at it, do more partitions. You don't hit a ceiling in terms of the kind of things that you can do with it, right? In terms of pure data operations. Right? So key benefits in this instance that we got is we got a much shorter lag for critical reporting. So anywhere from 13 to 37 hours was what we were taking. And that's something that came down to around 75 minutes. A scale-out model wherein even though we were handling 2 billion records per day, we could come back and add 10 more queues and handle 4 billion records per day kind of stuff. Right? An integrated set of technologies wherein relational database, queuing, compression, reporting, et cetera, was just one integrated solution. So we didn't have to fight around with multiple different options to come back and put something like this. Key takeaways, as part of SQL Server, it gives us a nice scale-out kind of model with multiple options in terms of how we can come back and work with it. Right? The service broker gives a robust queuing kind of a mechanism. Like I showed you, you can go from 200, 300 records per second that you insert into a table to a few thousands, 2,000 to 3,000 records, even on a laptop. Right? You can come back and do logical operations behind it, wherein your table inserts would drop down to like, you know, 2-3 per second, wherein the queue continues to handle 2,000-3,000 records per second. Right? And the primary benefit there is the fact that it's asynchronous and parallel. Table partitions allows table to scale to billions of records, but it gives you the benefit that you can plan it in such a way that the reads and writes at a given point in time are not looking at the same partition. Right? So it's a functional operation that we come back and do, but you can come back and have the reads working on a different partition, the writes working on a different partition. And whenever you are ready to archive, you can just switch using a pointer and get rid of the data instantly from the transactional table. And in the background, come back and do whatever you want on top of it. Right? You can leverage additional SQL features like database snapshots, compression, CLR, etc. to come back and put one integrated view of the kind of scalability that we can come back and achieve with it. Right, a few resources that I thought were interesting, architecting service broker application. You can quickly look around as part of this link. You will also get a link to how you can further optimize service broker queues. Right, so there's a white paper which is written in terms of conversation management, how you can handle it better, how you can take it from 2,000, 3,000 transactions per second to 10,000 to 20,000, 25,000 transactions per second kind of stuff. There is a link to partitioning tables and indexes, right, and a link to my email ID and stuff like that, right? So that's a bunch of resources that you can quickly take a look at. Some related content that we had, if you want to go back and have all the videos, you can link back to them and take a look at them. And a bunch of resources in terms of what we had. Right? This is something that we have reminded you multiple times. Please complete an evaluation, something that helps us a lot, right, on ComNet, and you get to win prizes as part of that. So given that it's the last session of TechEd, you have the last chance of entering a feedback, right? So before you head out to the party, just take a few minutes, enter the feedback, and then, take it. I hope it was worthwhile, and we'll open it up to questions. And I hope it was worthwhile in terms of information, in terms of the kind of things that SQL Server can come back and do.